up on the way out. Where you pick, you go up and the order pick it up right now. On the back is the elements of the service. It's the order of what happens here. It's the pieces that you may encounter today, and then a sentence about what they mean to us. We're looking for a meeting yet, so go ahead and grab one of these. And then on the other side of this is our new service series, which starts next week. There, we're doing a service series called The Delicate Dance, way back. We're talking about some of the most solemn dispositions that people have to faith in general, either coming back to God or encountering God or faith or anything like that for the first time. So grab one of these. They're in the entryway of the way out. Grab one. You can use it to invite someone, and then also come back again to get the elements of the service. If you want to stay connected to what's going on here, grab one of these cards in the pew in front of you or behind you. Put your name on there, your email, your phone number. If you haven't heard of us, put those on there. And if you have any financial information, you can give them online. Or put them in the send below. You can drop these in the baskets at the end of the way out here today. Let's begin with the word. God, the threats do not wait, and the dangers are not met. The power to undo is on the loose. And in it, you speak your word. It is your word that cuts the thread, that siphons off the danger, that changes the powers. And you speak, and all is made new. You speak your true self, your abiding faithfulness, a durable presence, and long-standing survival. You give yourself utterance of fear not, and we do not. We do not fear because you are with us. With us as we say, with us as we breathe, with us in charge. Now come here in compassion, come here in grace, come here in kindness. Here, there, override the fickleness of it all, and give us faith and measure of your true abiding self. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. That's why Jesus stands.
This one's an old one, but a good one. It's called In the
I want to touch.
It had antennas sticking out. time, and it always had the news on it. And I remember seeing it on that tiny TV. We had no idea what was going on. Class was getting out in like 15 minutes. 18 minutes after the first plane hit, while I'm probably walking to my next class, the second Boeing 767 appears out of the sky. It turns sharply towards the Trade Center, and it slices through the South Tower near the 60th floor. The collision caused an enormous explosion. It showered debris, surrounding buildings and people below. And now we could say America was under attack. On any given workday, 40 or 50,000 employees walked or worked in the World Trade Center. And an additional 40,000 passed through the Trade Center. As millions watched the event unfold in New York, American Airlines Flight 77 circled Washington, D.C., and it slammed into the west side of the Pentagon military headquarters an hour later at 9:45. Jet fuel from this Boeing 757 caused a devastating inferno that led to the structural collapse of a portion of this enormous building, too. All told, 125 military and civilians were killed in the Pentagon, along with 64 people aboard the airliner. After the September 11th attacks on the World Trade Center, the rescue and recovery cleanup of 1.8 million tons of wreckage took 9 months. And then that day, at about 9 o'clock at night, President George W. Bush, who had been flying around the country, staying safe, he finally made an address. And in his address, he said many things. But he said, at least and primarily this, terrorist attacks can shake the foundations of our biggest buildings, but they cannot touch the foundation of America. These acts shatter steel, but they cannot bend the steel of the American resolve. This week, if you were at our reading group on Thursday, I asked people to read this article from The Atlantic about free will. We were talking about, do we have a choice? Do people have an actual choice to respond, to do a thing in the world? Do you have the ability to lift your hand? Or did you make that choice? Do you have the ability to make a good or a bad decision when you're driving? Do you have the ability around here to make a good or bad decision when someone waves you across the road? Should you go? Should you not? Right? Do you have this capacity to learn and pursue good instead of merely being compelled by desire and appetite? It's kind of a Christian thing that, philosophers have been seeking this for a long time too, but Christians really pick it up. You can say most of Christianity, as it develops in the New Testament, is philosophy too. So, are we driven by our desire or our appetite, our instincts, or can we actually learn and seek out goodness? Do you believe this, that you have this freedom to do this? This opportunity, this liberty, this privilege of free choice? Can you indeed seek, learn, and choose what is good? This article hit in my palate. It deals with the idea of, cause and effect. That's where people operate on. That's where science says, this thing happened, therefore this happened. And so the article says, our deeds must be determined by something. Something must put our response into action. Let me read a little. Just compare it. Many scientists say that the American psychologist Benjamin Libet demonstrated in the 1980s that we have no free will. It was already known that electrical activity builds up in the person's brain before she or he, for example, moves her, his or her hand. Benjamin showed that this buildup occurs before the person consciously makes a decision to move. The conscious experience of deciding to act, which we usually associate with free will, appears to be an add-on, a post hoc reconstruction of events that occur after the brain has already set the act in motion. The 20th century nature versus nurture debate prepared us to think of ourselves as shaped by influences beyond our control. But it left some room, at least in the popular imagination, for the possibility that we could overcome our circumstances or our genes to become the author of our own destiny. The challenge posed by Nero conversation up here about this. We talked to you can kind of hear it in there. Like, how does it make you feel to know that maybe your brain, you choosing to do a thing, is just like your heart beating. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. You're going to do that thing. Your brain is already making electrical pathways for me to put my hand right here before I put my hand here. Therefore, did I even choose to put my hand here? Right? We're getting pretty deep in the weeds here. One of the things that it talks about in the article is that the things that shape, that make your brain fire in certain ways are your genes, right? What's in you and your environment. It's the nature versus the nurture. What environments are you in? Here are a bunch of different environments that you might, or that you, the article suggests, and I would suggest too, are shaping and forming you. Environments are fixed, a mold, if you will. They're punching out likeness after likeness of the original. Your brain continues to do the same thing. When a ball comes flying at your face, you go like this. If you're my mom, for some reason your leg comes up too, right? And like, that's what happens. So surely there is an evolutionary advancement in the mold, meaning that the molds get better and better. The capacity of your brain to think gets better and better. Civilization continues to create more and more exciting, advanced things, but all following in the same movement. It still looks like a hand lift when the ball is flying at your face. But the environments are kicking out what they know how to produce. My parents produced two kids. Should we not be exactly the same? These are your environments, your age, your ability. Have you ever considered your ability and the freedom you have and your ability to go and do things? These are environments that probably shape who you are. Maybe a couple other ones, what year it is, that shapes who you are and how you choose to do things. What technology is present in the world shapes who you are. Imagine how Martin Luther would have instigated the Reformation in the 1500s if he had Twitter. Things would be different. The year matters. Therefore, technology now matters based on the year. The way your country survived or didn't, based on the kind of weaponry that was around, the amount you could travel. Jesus didn't go very far because he didn't have anything to get there other than a camel and his feet. You are a product of your environment. So then, in theory, you cannot say how you might act as a pilot on an airplane 15 years ago. Because, well, you don't have the environment kneading and molding you into the person you are now, or into the person that pilot was. Your genetic code isn't the same. You can't be that person. You can't even imagine correctly what it's like to be that person. You can only be you, remembering a story about a pilot, as you are shaped by your different environments. You are a product. One of the other questions the article asked was, so what does this say about moral responsibility? If we are all a product of the environments and the firings in our brains well before we chose to be that thing, what does it say about the way we respond to things in the world? How do we be good? Remember, Christianity and philosophy from the early on was trying to figure out, how to learn and pursue good, but if we're just instinctually looking for food and sex and shelter, there's no time for good. We've got to stay alive. So what does moral responsibility look like if we're being pushed down the chute of in our environment? To be plopped out on the other end, slightly more advanced, but over time really not that much, but predictably the same as the last person pushed out the environment, just like will people simply give up looking for good if they know they can't choose it anymore? That was the point of the article. At least the most exciting point of it. In 1951, a guy named Solomon Ash, he did this thing called the conformity experiment. experiment. And it was really simple. There were 8 people in each group, and they, I think they tested each group like 7 times, and there were 12 people in a group. So there were 7 people who all knew the answer to this question. And there was one person, and they were informed. The 7 people were informed to answer a specific way. Always to answer right for the first 3 times, and then answer wrong for the last, you know, however many times they did, maybe 9 times. There was only one person in the room who this experiment was actually being tested on. And that person always was positioned to answer last. And so what happened is, the goal was to find out, well, which, if X is the line, which of A, B, C is the exact same length? Does anybody know?
Which one is it?
C, yes. Yes, it's not a trick question. Even then, in a giant room, with just you answering first, you're still like, but you know which one it is, right? If you were to write it down and put it in your pocket and show no one, you would definitely write C. They found out that 75% of the time, or 75% of participants, got at least one answer wrong because they were conforming to what everyone else said. And the reasons were like, well, you know, I don't know what was doing it, so I did it, right? Or I didn't want to like make anyone upset, or whatever they could have been. 40% of people conform completely to did what everyone else said. Think of that. I tell you that not to say that, to give you an example of an environment shaping. For the teachers in here, you're like, man, I got a lot of power, I can really mess with people. Don't. That's an environment changing and shaping you. And you might even know it and feel it. You're like, oh, I probably shouldn't do that. I should go for the good, true answer here. Well, I don't know if it's necessarily good. It's not necessarily morally good to answer C. But maybe after a while, you're like, this is 7 in a row where I said the wrong thing. I am doing something wrong in my life. That's when it starts to become more of a morality issue. You are a product of your environment, says the article. So then where is hope? I ask, where is their freedom? What is the resolve of Americans, as President George W. Bush said, that we can hold to? Where is their reform? Where is their change? Where is their hope, given the scientific evidence of neurons, electricity in our brains, and our survival instincts? Let me invite you to another story. It's one that has been going on for quite a long time. It's about an idea that became a person that became the most shaping and creative thing in the world. It's about God and the way that God changes current environments. We read in our scripture today. You've heard this before. It's all over the Bible in different places. It's in the early first 5 books, the Torah writings. It's in the Psalms. It's in the minor prophets and the major prophets. You see it in the New Testament and some of the authors there spanning 2,500 years of time in writing. You see this phrase that says, the Lord is merciful and compassionate, slow to anger, filled with unfailing love. The Lord is good to heaven. It was astonishing to say then. Now it's sort of like the thing that makes it on a throw pillow or makes it onto a tree. Of driftwood sold in a barn to families carrying caribou coffee and expensive puffy vests on a Saturday afternoon. You hang it up over by your door. It's that kind of phrase, right? The Lord is merciful and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding with unfailing love. We have one in our house that says, bless the Lord, O my soul. Someone painted it. We paid a lot of money for it. We should have. That's what that phrase is now. But it wasn't. It wasn't back then. It was incredibly revolutionary. It was radical. It was pioneering. It was the leading edge. It was so ahead in position. You've ever heard that be a leader that isn't so ahead that it doesn't look like you're walking alone or something like that. It doesn't matter. It was so far ahead, it looked like it was going the wrong way. This idea that God is compassionate and merciful, slow to anger, and unfailing in love. Because of all the other gods. there are many. I'm going to pick on one today. The name was Molek. If you want to learn more about this, I'll get James in here and talk to you for about 10 hours straight. You'll love it, but you probably never want to think about it again. This guy, Molek, guy, more like a person cover. It's a giant, they would get a bull head, now a real bull head. And if you could afford it, you would make one out of bronze or something. And you put it on the body, not a real person, this would be a molded person, like a body shape, and it would have arms in it, it's a furnace. And inside, it was said that like fertility or bad events would happen or whatever, and you would sacrifice children. This was Molek. This was unbelievably common during the time that people are saying in the Bible. God is compassionate, slow to anger. Slow to anger? All this says to me is that's an angry God. There's actually one guy in Carthage. He said that the brass Molek idol in their city had moving arms that would lift the person into the fire. Inside the furnace, their screams were distorted to sound like the God's laughter. Now, when you hear that, when you know that, and you hear the Lord is merciful, compassionate, slow to anger, filled with unfailing love, the Lord is good to everyone, you're going, I don't believe it. The Lord I have, my child was killed because of that. So this is going to shake people at their core. But if it sinks in, people are going to start thinking, wow, maybe that's really good news. It's like gospel good news. That changes lives. So here we see God changing entire lives. That is the kind of God that we find in the scriptures. I will suggest that God is saying, I'm changing the way the entire religious sacrificial environment works. Or if you struggle with the idea of God saying anything out loud, which is fair, you can. People said, we are changing the way the entire religious sacrificial system works. For some, the difference between people who change things for good and God is very different. Some might say those who do good are the very coming of God to the world. Some, or one of these people, could be indeed a person named Jesus. Jesus said this, he demonstrated it constantly. It doesn't matter what the miracle was, it doesn't matter what kind of teaching, he was always saying, sure, I don't think he had this article. Maybe he knew. Maybe he was like, your environment's, it's been said that your environments shape you. But I think Jesus is saying and telling us that we can change our environments. Jesus tells us where there is complacency, that is not God. Where there is dereliction, that is not God. Where there are burning children, that is not God. Where there is injustice, that is not God. He tells us where there is wrong judgment, that is not God. Where there are towers falling, that is not God. Jesus tells us that where there is compassion, grace, slowness to anger, overflowing kindness, abounding love, displayed in the willingness to die for the sake of one but also many, well, there is God. He's carrying that message that we do change, that we change the environments, that we are the agents of change. We determine what happens. We are dynamic, full of potential. We are life-bringing, threatened to overflow into the experience of other people around us. Jesus tells us we can change our environment. On September 11th, Tuesday, during the day before, sometime after 10 o'clock, while the other planes are flying into towers and the Pentagon, a fourth California-bound airplane, United Flight 93, was hijacked about 40 minutes after leaving Newark International Airport in New Jersey, so not far away. Because this plane specifically, had been delayed in taking off, passengers on board learned the events in New York via cell phones or air phone calls or whatever it was, calls to the ground. plane had been hijacked, and hijackers said,
"Hey, we're just going to go back to an airport."
A group of passengers and flight attendants planned an insurrection. Their brains and neurons were firing. One of the passengers, Thomas Burnett Jr., he told his wife over the phone, he said this, "I know we're all going to die. There's three of us who are going to do something about it. I love you." Another passenger, Todd Bieber, was heard saying, "Are you guys ready? Let's roll." Sandy Bradshaw, flight attendant, called her husband, explained that she had slipped into a galley and was filling pitchers with oil and water. Her last words to him were, "Everyone's running to first class. I've got to go. Bye." The passengers fought the four hijackers and are suspected to have attacked the cockpit with a fire extinguisher. Then the plane flipped over and it sped towards the ground at 500 miles an hour, and it crashed into a rural field in Pennsylvania at 10 a.m. All 45 people on board were killed. The intended target, speculated, is the White House, the U.S. Capitol, Camp David, where the presidential retreat was in Maryland, and several other nuclear power plants along the eastern seaboard. The environment did not dictate what those people did. "Let's roll," he said. For the next 5 weeks, or next week into the five after, we're talking about the most stalling dispositions, as I said. And this new sermon series called The Delicate Dance. We're talking about exhaustion, isolation, heartbreak, inadequacy, superstition, and cynicism. Each devoted 1 week to them. We're talking about these emotional blocks, these experiential sour moments in our lives that make us say, "No, I couldn't ever come back, or believe even for the first time, there's a God, let alone one who's compassionate, gracious, and slow to anger, and filled with unfailing kindness." There's no way that I can believe in one that shows compassion. "Show me compassion," says anyone who consumes the news once a week. What we're suggesting for the next 6 weeks and today is that together, us here and out there, God here and there, it's all worth the effort back. It's all worth the effort for the first introduction or thought about God. It's entirely life-giving and indeed possesses the necessary potency to change environments. It's worth it. It's worth it to consider the reality of God. So today, I encourage you, be well, knowing the Christian faith at its best has been one to bring goodness, graciousness, wholeness to the world, and together, we say the kingdom of God is here and coming evermore as we, people of the Creator and creation, as we take responsibility for what is ours and what is another's for the sake of the world. That, my friends, is good news worth the wait. Okay, let's pray. God, we are grateful this day for the people in our lives. We are grateful for the people sitting next to us. We are grateful for the people that have gone before us to shape us as we are. And we are excited about the future and what we will make together. We thank you for the way that people serve, that they gave willingly on 9/11. We pray that this would always shape us, that it would never produce just one thing, but it would encourage us to be creative in the way that we love, carrying the weight of everyone, because we know they carry it for us. God, we thank you for your sustaining power, the way it speaks through the Bible and through each one of us this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing a couple more songs. I invite you to stand or sit for this first song, whatever you'd like. Then we'll stand together for the last one. I invite you to reflect on things you've heard, thought. You can come up here and kneel and pray. You can stay where you are and pray. You can leave. Thank you.
sing this next song, I invite you to stand and sing with me. It's called One Thing, Three Things.
Come find me, we'll watch the Vikings game, we'll cheer hard. So, with that, I